So right. funny that when I started doing stand-up, I was actually on house arrest. Oh. I had the anklet on my leg.
You really did?
I really did. True story. Right hand to
Why were you under house arrest?
Now, you asked too many personal questions. There you go. I gave you enough information. You have to do your research.
This is What a Joke.
With Tom Papa and Fortune Feimster.
On Netflix is a joke radio.
Oh, yeah. Hey. Welcome to What a Joke with Papa and Fortune. I'm Tom Papa.
I'm Fortune Feimster.
And we are refreshed and ready to go.
Feeling good.
Looking good.
Smelling good.
I feel like you did something.
I did stand-up shows.
Is that what it is?
I do them every weekend right now.
I don't know. There's something else going on.
Oh, am I beautiful?
Well, you're always beautiful, but you have a certain glow. What are you up to?
Did I get sun-kissed?
Did you do? Maybe. Maybe that's what it is.
Feel a little sun?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Are you noticing something different?
Yeah, there's something going on. I don't know. Maybe it's love. Maybe, I don't know. Maybe you had good shows. Maybe you found money in your pockets. Maybe,
all of the above.
Maybe something appeared in your snack drawer. I don't know what it is. I could tell. Good to see everybody. We have a good show for you today. We have two comedians handpicked by Tiffany Haddish for Tiffany Haddish Presents They Ready. It's a new Netflix comedy showcase, and we're going to have two of the comedians on the show today.
I always took the longer road, the harder road in life, like with dating women. I grew up mostly around men, so when I came out the closet, I just took their lead, you know? I went and bought the equipment and everything because I thought I was supposed to be tough. Now I'm about ready to give him my gay card because I thought this shit was going to be easy. I used to see all the dudes in my family. They ain't had to cook or clean. They got to hang out with mad chicks. I was like, I want that role in my life. I didn't know I was going to have to be the defender of my relationship. Like, I remember these dudes being disrespectful to my girl, and she looking at me like, you just going to let them talk to me like that? I'm like, now, hold on, baby. I just play a man, all right? This shit is not real right here. It's like, matter of fact, let me take this shit off right now. You just... Here's the deal, though. I lost all my benefits being a female. I lost all of them. Like, if I want somebody to open the door for me, guess who gotta do it? Me. If I'm cold, I'm just fucking cold. I gotta pay for my bills and my girl's bills. I need to find me a man just so I can recoup half of the fucking money I spent dating you chicks, right? And it's crazy because a lot of dudes are switching over now too, so shit is just getting weird completely. Real talk. Dudes' clothes getting so tight, it's turning me back into a fucking female. I tried to go shopping the other day. I was like, hey, where's the men's section? They was like, this is the men's section. I was like, blouses and leggings? What is this, the Migos collection?
You were handpicked by Tiffany.
I was handpicked by Tiffany.
That's so great.
Yeah.
No, do you guys go way back?
We do go way back. Man, like 2000, I think I started comedy in 2003.
Yeah.
So probably around like 5, 06.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But there was like a group of us that used to get together, comedians from like Atlanta and stuff like that. Vanessa Fraction.
Uh-huh.
And we used to always just get together. And I don't know, Tiffany and I... I get like Tiffany and I, we just there was never any like beef,
right,
between, you know, the circle that we had. And mm-hmm. I think that's what was amazing about us. It's like if I heard about an audition,
mm-hmm.
you know,
right,
especially through my family, like I would be like, I think you should come out and do it. Right. And I would do the same audition. They'd be like, man, Tiffany Haddish was amazing. I'd be like, so I'm still in PA. Okay, I'm going to go get your coffee.
But that's nice, funny. Looking out for each other, you know, looking out for your friends.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, for everybody at home, Chaunté Wayans, you are correct. She is a Wayans.
Yes. You're part I thought that's how you was going to start it.
Yeah.
That was pretty cool.
That was pretty tricky.
Yeah.
You probably get that a lot.
No. It's like... Do you guys not listen to each other's interviews?
We were talking about how Marlon was in here, and we said that he was eating salads.
Yeah, and I just want to say this for the record that Marlon doesn't eat like that. All of a sudden, he got into this space of, like, he calls it grinding, you know, like you got to hustle.
Yeah.
You know, you always
yeah.
got to hustle. So we would take a red eye to go perform where we were going. Red eye, get in at like 6 o'clock, get to the hotel, don't even really get to do anything, put the bags down. We got radio.
Oh, man.
So we do radio from like 7 to maybe 12. Uh-huh. Then he wants to go eat. Uh-huh. Mind you, we have 3 shows that night.
Yeah.
So all of this is happening. It's like 4 o'clock. We eat everything like that. And then he goes, all right, I'm going to take a nap and then we're going to go to the gym. What?
To the gym.
to the gym before the show. I'm like, bro, do you know all the stuff that you're going to make me do when I get to the show?
Yeah.
You're
not, yeah, no. I'm a comedian.
I'm a comedian.
I need to lay down.
Oh, my gosh.
And then you would have to help him out with all his merch and all that kind of
with
stuff?
The merch, the pictures, talking to the club people.
It's a family affair.
I was like, please let me come back to this club. Put your numbers. but I mean, Marlon's hilarious because I laugh at his eating habits because he'll take us out, which we're so grateful for, and then he'll be like, he's like, what you getting? And you're like, let me get this steak. All right, I'm going to get the lambs and we're going to split it. So he'll order like all the stuff.
He'll coordinate all the meals.
Yeah. You want dessert? No, but let's.
Oh my gosh.
We got to share.
That's hilarious. Did you tour with just Marlon or any other?
I toured with him and Sean.
Okay.
I was touring like both kind of that weekend was going on. I'm like, hey.
Yeah.
That's great.
But then Damon was like my first. The first person to take me on tour.
Oh, that's cool.
Oh,
that's
really?
We were horrible.
Oh, like, yeah?
Had 2 jokes getting booed at theaters.
No.
Oh, man.
Is this supposed to happen?
Oh, my
How
gosh.
Old? How old were you?
Oh, man. 2003. So maybe like 23, 24.
Wow. Yeah. And you're just going thrown right into
we just,
these theater
shows? Yeah,
he was
shows? Like, just come on stage. We had like 2 jokes. I thought I was hot because I did the open mic for the first time and they asked me to come back for the main show.
Ah,
so I
there
was like,
go.
Oh,
this is easy.
Got it. And, you know, we go out and, in front of thousands of
people.
Oh, my
gosh. That's so intimidating.
And they just like, boo, you're not a Wayans.
You're like, look
I just
at my life
yesterday.
You're not a Wayans.
Like, so mean.
Is it a requirement in y'all's family that everyone do comedy?
No.
Feels like everyone's so funny.
No, I mean, because we just, you know, my mom had me and my brother, like, she's 16 to 18.
Okay.
So we grew up in that house of already 10 plus my grandma and grandpa.
Wow.
And then it was like my cousin Craig and my brother and I. So we're all smashed in this like bunk bed, 2-bedroom apartment.
Yeah.
And so anyway, we just grew up together. So we, you know, Marlon was like probably 13, 14 when we were like coming up with him and stuff like that. And Marlon would, you know, Marlon was always just, he would like purposely eat everything he could that makes your breath smell really bad.
Oh no.
And then he would like lick your face. And it was, it took me so while to get over this.
So he's kind of more like a brother.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right?
No, him, Sean, they're kind of like a, you know, more like a brother and Keenan. But we was kind of around when everything started to pop off and, you know, like the In Living Color and stuff like that. We was around for those.
That must have been exciting.
It was amazing.
So,
I mean,
yeah,
I didn't understand it.
You know,
I can look back now and be like, oh, I knew J-Lo. And,
right? You know, yeah.
All these people. But at the time, I was just happy to possibly be able to miss school the next day because we'll be out so late.
There you go.
What was dope about our family is like having a team of punch-ups.
Yeah.
So you say something that gets this person started that heightens that. And then Sean will like impersonate somebody, and then Damon will up impersonate. And so then you have all these like different levels, and then you have the one Wayans who's not famous that tries to say a joke.
Oh, no.
You haven't had your worst show unless you came to a dinner of the Wayans.
Yeah.
And it gets silent, and then we all have this like different levels of just this
making
burst
fun of
piling on.
No, it's just this burst. It's like, but we all have these different levels of it. And so, anyway, so that was that.
So naturally, you are doing comedy in your house already. So it kind of just is a way of life.
Yeah. But I never, you know, I was more of an introvert growing up. I never wanted to get that silence.
Really?
You know, until I got older. And it was weird because seeing what I saw, I really didn't like the industry. I didn't like going out to dinner when you haven't seen them for a while. And then you can't even really have dinner because people are coming up, pictures.
Right.
I mean, even at funerals. Like, we would be at a funeral,
man.
And freaking people would like my sorry my grandma's sister passed away, and we get to this funeral, and it's like this party. It's like a 2-for-1 Wayans party. The kids didn't even speak about their mom. They, you know, had Marlon and Kim come up, and then they left my aunt. Like, they wanted to take pictures so bad, they left her in the funeral. Oh, no. Like, we're supposed to be walking her out, taking her to get buried and stuff like that. But it was like a quick moment. We went back and got her. But it was just like,
right. Oh, yeah, we forgot something.
Yeah. She's like in the casket.
I don't know. Got overshadowed by Marlon.
These are like old church woman looking people. So you walk in going, this is not going to be that bad. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, they don't even know how to Snapchat and all that stuff. They have more technology than I ever.
Oh my gosh.
So it seemed like it must be kind of a cool advantage mentally to think, like, to see show business happening and like that it's possible. Like, I didn't know anybody that was in comedy. I was just like, is it, how do you get there?
Right.
It must have been a little bit of a mental help for you to see at least there's a path.
Yeah, when I liked computers. So I went to college for a semester to do computer science. Uh-huh. Hated it. Hated what I was learning at the time. So when I moved out to Cali, I was able to see that world. And what was dope about it was because I was into computers, I got into editing. I wish I would have liked, you know, got into like After Effects and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But I started to see that stuff. And that's what kind of like, I guess being around it and trying to find that voice, I found the stage, and that's, you know, that's what I fell in love with.
Was it the opposite? Was it almost like you were hesitant to put yourself out there because there would be judgment from your family?
Not from my family. Because when I started comedy, I could call Sean. Sean was like the guy who started me, you know, helping me figure out how to formulate jokes and stuff like that. And then, you know, I would be able to call them at like 3 o'clock in the morning. I'd be like, yo, I'm in New York and I bombed. And they're like, well, they would never say like, well, scratch that joke. It's just like, well, how'd you say it? And I'm like, and they're like, okay, well, you could have missed a word or, you know, just certain things. And they would come to shows and, you know, if you get stuck on stage, they're like, what else? And then what if this person did that?
They'd yell it out while you're on stage.
You're just like, and so, you know, it always feels good. Like, even if I bomb, if I have my family or people that I grew up in with this, it makes it feel better because it's like, oh, it's not that you just bombed. It's just like it didn't come off
right.
Funny.
It's just something to work on.
Yeah.
Right.
My brother's never helped me. God.
He didn't come to show.
I would love
nothing.
Helping jokes. Jeez.
He just didn't come watch.
Barely.
But the older I get, I swear, the older I get, I really confirm, it's really affirmed that the richer and more powerful white people get, the more black and gangster they act. I swear to God. The richer a white person get with some power, they just turn to a straight gangster, old vice lord from Chicago. I.E., Speaker of the House, 4'9", Nancy Pelosi. Nancy Pelosi gangster. Nancy Pelosi say, look at here, Orange Crush. Look at here, homie. Ain't no money for no wall, nigga. Fuck you and your mail order, Brad White. But the biggest gangster of all, ladies and gentlemen, the owner of Amazon, Jeff Bezos. He pulled a nigga move if I ever saw one in my life, goddamn. They said, we got some dick pics of you. We gonna show them if you don't give us $1 billion. Jeff Bezos stood back, folded his arms like a nigga in jail, looked at you with that one good eye, and that other eye that closed really, really slowly, like one of them 70s baby dolls, and said, show that motherfucker. I said, ooh, that was a black man move. Jeff Bezos said, I got dick like Subway. It started off as a 6-inch, but depending on what size you add, it turned into a foot long right there. Now y'all know why they call it Amazon Prime.
Flame is part of the Tiffany Haddish Presents They Ready.
The only transgender urban comedian. How about that?
That's
single dad by day, drag queen by night.
It's awesome.
I just met her outside.
I can already tell Flame is hilarious.
She's going to be great. She's going to be great.
And beautiful. Flame looks.
Yeah.
Flame looks so beautiful.
Yes, here she comes.
In a beautiful dress.
Hiya, Flame. Flame Monroe is on the show.
Welcome.
I'm a white rapper.
I'm like the,
I'm the vanilla ice of comedy.
Thanks for being
Thanks
here.
Thanks for coming.
Good morning.
Good morning. Thanks for coming to our show.
Thank you for having me.
This is exciting. You're part of Tiffany Haddish Presents.
I am, and I drove all the way from Long Beach. I'm trying to put these headphones on without knocking his wig off. Y'all didn't pay for that.
You don't have to wear them if you don't want to. You can hear us.
You live in Long Beach?
I do. I'm from Chicago, though. Gotcha. But I've been here for 12 years.
So how did you and Tiffany meet?
Okay, so I've been doing comedy for 19 years collectively, off and on. Mm-hmm. And
in Chicago?
I started in Chicago at a club called All Jokes Aside on an open mic night as a dare. So right. Funny that when I started doing stand-up, I was actually on house arrest.
Oh.
I had the anklet on my leg.
You really did?
I really did. True story. Right hand to
Why were you under house arrest?
Now you're asking too many personal questions.
There you go.
I gave you enough information. You have to do your research, darling.
Come on, Flame.
I was not the sweetest girl
Flame
back
was
in
like,
the day.
I've got a pass.
Of course I do. Everybody does.
Yeah.
But he did work for the presidency, so why not just tell it down? He got a pass and he won.
Right.
Maybe I should run for president. That would be great.
Yeah. Anything's possible.
So I started at All Jokes Aside, and then I met Tiffany maybe 10 years ago at a club here in LA, and Tiffany was so cute. She was the cutest little thing. So she walked up to me. She says, "Oh my God, can I ask you a question?" I said, "Yeah." She said, "Are you a drag queen?" So I just looked at her. She was so innocent and adorable because I would have like, "Girl, if you don't get out of my face." But I was like, "I am." She's like, "Oh, you're so pretty. I didn't know. I wasn't sure." But she asked. So I appreciated that she at least asked. And it was very innocent.
Yeah.
And we started talking. I went on stage. She said, "Oh, my God, you were so funny. I want to be as funny as you." I was like, "Girl, you're going to be a huge star one day because you're too cute."
Yeah.
And we just clicked.
That's
so
right.
I taped the TV show Botched a couple of years ago because they fixed one of my boobs. My left boob was gangbanging. It was just leaning to the left.
What was wrong with it?
It was leaning to the left. It had just said, I quit. I'm tired. I'm done. It just
tapped
was
out.
On its own way. Yeah, it completely
on,
tapped out.
It was on house arrest.
It was off house arrest, and it was free in the yard. So they needed someone to introduce me. So this was pre-girls trip. No one knew this Tiffany Haddish.
Right.
And so I asked her to come to introduce me because I've always thought she was a delightful person. Yeah. And she did. And I told the producers, I said, "You need to watch this girl. This girl is going to be a star." 6 months later, girls trip came out. Tiffany Haddish is a household name.
Yeah, huge.
But she just has always been accommodating to me. So she said to me on that day when we did the reveal for Bot, she said, "If I make it, I'm coming back to get you."
Mm-hmm.
I've heard that from many celebrities. I have many celebrity friends.
Yeah.
But Tiffany was the only one who stayed true to her word. So I love Tiffany Haddish.
She's amazing.
That's awesome.
She is completely a wonderful person.
Mm-hmm. She really is.
So I've been knowing her long. She's been at my house at barbecues.
Yeah.
She gave us a dog one Christmas.
That's great.
We have that kind of relationship.
Yeah.
So what I love about Tiffany is that Tiffany knew I was a comic. She also knew I was a different type of comic. You know, I'm a comedian.
Right.
I just happen to be transgender. And I say that in my stand up.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And Tiffany looked past all of that. Tiffany said, "Just come funny."
Yeah.
I'm like, "Okay, let's do it." Because a lot of places I couldn't get booked because I looked different or because I was, so they thought I was going to get on stage and talk about men and, you know, the traditional gay transgender stuff. I'm like, nothing could be further. I talk about everything. I'm a dad.
Right.
I got kids. I got baby mama drama. I got bills. I got everything going on that you got going on.
Right.
Yeah. I just wear dresses when I do it. This is my uniform.
How many kids do you have?
I have 3 kids.
3 kids?
Unfortunately, yes. I was on the rhythm method, but my dancing skills have never been up to par. 16, 16, and 12.
So twins.
Oh, I'm right there. I've got 17
No, they're Irish twins. I had 2 different baby mamas, both named Tosh. They was both pregnant at the same time. Oh, don't let these titties fool you.
Okay.
There's a brother up under here. Don't let these titties fool you.
Flame. Putting out flames in Chicago.
I wish I would have pulled out the flame.
Well, Botch did a good job.
Botch did a great job.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. See, when a man compliments your boobs, then you know they're good.
Yeah.
That's right.
It's the first thing I said when I came in. I'm like, "Wait, do you see this?
These are new boobs."
Yeah, they are looking good.
Thank you, Dr. Terry Dubrow. I love you.
Oh, that's right. From the Housewives.
Yeah. Oh, he's the nicest guy.
Really?
I told him, I said, "I know you looked up under my robe while I was asleep." I said, you're going to be jealous, though. I told him beforehand, I said, if you look up at my role, well, I said, you're going to be jealous.
Oh.
He told me later that he did, and he was.
You got it all.
I am a blessed woman. I'm almost a whole California girl, though.
I love it.
I am. I got Hollywood smile, Beverly Hills tits, a Long Beach ass, and a Compton in the front. I'm not going to say the word because I don't want to be. Is this regular
Compton
radio? Can I say
front.
What I want to say? Yeah. Can I use the colorful language?
You can
yeah.
say
oh, whatever you want to say.
God, I'm not going to do that.
Flame is in here with her fan.
It's called Fan the Flame.
Fan
that's
the Flame.
That's what the world is going
to
do.
You already have merch
Tuesday.
Ready to go.
Oh, I've been ready to go.
Yeah. This is good.
This is really good.
This is going to be really good for you.
It seems kind of like surreal because it's so huge. When I saw the billboard in Times Square, it really overwhelmed me.
Oh,
like,
really?
With unspeakable joy because I'm like, oh my God, this is fucking huge.
Yeah.
So I'm going to have me a Mary Tyler Moore moment next Thursday.
Yes.
Good for you.
I might throw
Enjoy
my wig
it.
Up and my hat.
Well, it's got to feel good, especially after 19 years
of the struggle because yeah. What I kept hearing was, we think you're very talented, Flame Monroe. We just don't know what to do with you.
Mm-hmm.
So Tiffany found something to do with me. But now, and I was pre RuPaul's Drag Race. Yeah. I was pre anything transgendered on TV. Mm-hmm. So I was really an anomaly. Like, we don't know, you know. And for 10 years, I worked in the business with A-list comics that would sit in the green room with me and wouldn't even speak to me.
Oh, really?
For real?
Seriously.
Wow.
Like, baby, what I'm going to do? If you talk to me, I'm going to jump on you.
Yeah.
I got gator, I'm going to turn you.
Uh-huh.
No, they just were so...
Just uncomfortable
and
or very. Something?
And I guess they figured, well, Flame ain't going nowhere. Shit, every time we come, she here. Because
uh-huh.
I was trying to get good at my craft.
Right.
This is my passion. I wanted to do this.
Yeah.
So I wasn't going to. And it was very disheartening for a while because, of course, you want camaraderie amongst your constituents, you know?
Of course.
I want to talk to you and tell me, how was the set? How's the crowd? Mm-hmm. I couldn't get any of that.
Oh, that's
so
that's...
I would kill the crowd, but couldn't get no love from my counterparts in the green room.
Mm-hmm. Man, oh man.
It's different now. It's changed.
Yeah.
It has changed.
Now they treat me like one of the fellas. Once I flame, they hug
oh,
me,
really?
Grab on the titties. I'm just one of the boys now. And, you know, I receive that because I wanted that for so long. Just see me as a comedian. Don't worry about what I'm doing in my personal life because it's not affecting you.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
When do you think it began to shift and you started feeling more
I
acceptance?
Do think that us being more transparent on TV now has helped. It let the curtain down some.
Mm-hmm.
So people are just like, and then they saw, in all these years, I never had a reputation of anybody saying, oh, Flame pushed up on me, Flame hit on me. Mm-hmm. I have a list, but I've never made anybody's list.
Right. Oh,
but I keep my list to myself.
Oh, man,
right.
If you could...
I would never.
That list could talk.
I would never.
Just one of them, right?
I mean, what good would that do my career, honestly?
Right.
Me destroying somebody else's life or their livelihood. That's not even who I am.
Does one of those names rhyme with fortune?
Smorchin?
No.
I've never met Flame, or else I'd have been on that list.
I'd proudly be on that list.
I am not sharing that. That's another story, another day.
Yeah, I love it.
Like when I'm on my deathbed.
There you go.
But how mighty are you that you're living this life, which is naturally at the time kind of not allowing you to be included in a lot of ways, and then go into a career that puts yourself right out there in the spotlight and then be in those green rooms and still feeling that? That takes a very strong person to keep going.
I truly believe what my grandmother told me. You don't know how strong you are until you have to be.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't know anything else. And I want to test who I am because I've always accepted me because I had a great stability with my grandmother.
Yeah.
So I've always known that I was different, but I want to thank Norman Lear. I want to thank Beverly LaSalle. May she rest in peace. And I want to thank Diana Ross. So Norman Lear in 73 or 74, I was a huge All in the Family fan.
Yeah.
I loved All in the Family. In 73, Norman Lear had a drag queen on the show. Her name was Beverly LaSalle was the character. I didn't even know she was a drag queen. I was 6 or 7 years old.
Uh-huh.
So I thought something was wrong with me because I knew I felt like a girl. I wanted to wear girls' clothes. And so when I saw Beverly LaSalle on this episode of All in the Family and snatched her wig off, I went to the bathroom and I cried like a baby because I was floored. I knew then I was not the only one. There was nothing wrong with me.
Amazing.
So that had always resonated in me that you okay. You're going to be okay. And then I saw Diana Ross host the American Music Awards in like 71 or 72. She changed after every commercial. I knew then I had to be a girl. That just took me over the edge. I don't know who won what award. I was just waiting for the commercial to be over so I could see what gown Diana Ross had on.
She's gorgeous.
I was destined to be a great queen.
Yeah. People have no idea how much that representation matters.
At that time, you know, it was unheard of. Yeah. 73, 74. Because now if you do something like that, everybody had their panties in a bunch. Mm-hmm. So yeah. Norman Lear had his finger on the pulse 100 years ago. And I hope that my special in 190 countries shows some little boy or some little girl in some dark part corner of the world that I'm okay. Yeah. I'm going to be all right. Because you have to accept who you are. Mm-hmm. And don't go to meet people. Let them come meet you.
Right.
I make people come to meet me. If you don't like me, that's cool. Because I got a motto. I don't like nobody that don't like me. Mm-hmm. That's it.
That's great.
It's too much weight. I can't carry all of that and all of this.
Yeah.
Well, it will make a difference for
sure. It does. And you know, the problem to me with the young children now is that we don't have representation to give us the honest truth. We do have some people out there that's on the battlefield that's supposed to be trans this, they're fighting for trans rights or whatever, but their philosophies are different than mine because I strongly believe, I'm not going to say her name, but I've heard someone who's very popular in the trans community that's like an advocate for us to say, I was born and the doctors assigned me a male. You were born with a working penis and testicles. What else were they going to call you? Mm-hmm. So what that does to me is cloud the mind of the youth to make them feel like they hate their genitalia. Uh-huh. If you hate your genitalia before you transition, you're going to hate your genitalia after you transition. I love all of me.
Oh,
so you can't tell kids. What you should tell kids is that I was blessed enough to find out who I was, blessed with the wherewithal and the tenacity to change to live the lifestyle that I wanted to live, as opposed to telling somebody 6 or 7, oh, you were born with a vagina, but the doctors call you a boy.
Right.
It's so confusing.
It is.
And with all the alphabets, I can't keep up with the alphabets. It's too many alphabets in the gay community.
For all the LGBT. Listen,
all, baby, you, let me tell you something. I'm old school. You either like penis or vagina, or both.
Right.
That's it. Penis, because after you get through all the alphabets, asexual, bisexual, crockpot sexual, skillet sexual. When you get through with all of that, it's only penis or vagina or both.
Right.
So what?
Right.
So I can say I'm z-sexual. What the hell is that? Because when you get in the bed, it's only three things there. Penis or a vagina. Or if you like me, some days I feel like a nut. Some days I don't.
There you go.
It's muddy in the waters to the youth, and it's confusing them. And I'm telling you, that's why we have so much teen suicide amongst, especially the trans community.
Yeah.
Because we don't have anybody out there to just be completely honest about the situation. I love all of me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, I added on. I never took anything off. I've only added on. I never took anything off of me.
There was never a thought to.
Never. Right. I like, thank God for Jesus.
Yeah.
Some of the men would be mad. I mean, I must have stood in line in the penis line in heaven like 3 times before they released me. But not even with that, you just have to accept whatever you have and make the best of what you are, because you'll find your fulfillment and your joy in that.
Right.
Instead of trying to be somebody, I don't want to be this girl or this guy. I just want to be flame.
It was a treat having you.
Thank you guys so much. Y'all make sure y'all tune in and look for the pretty bitch in the blue dress.
I
would say I'm the devil in a blue dress, but I'm an angel today.
Well, we were blessed.
Thank you so much for coming in.
Thanks for watching What a Joke.
Make sure to comment, like, subscribe.
Tell us what guests you'd like us to have on.
Yeah. You tell us.
Do something.